Game Master, Richard Neville. Earl of Warwick, Maker of Kings. Going to battle for Henry, the rightful King of England. Long live King Henry!
Richard Neville, Earl of Warwick, call you to arms. Men of England, I call you to arms. In our country is the illegitimate traitor Edward with foreign powers. The kingdom is threatened. Your households are threatened. Saddle your horses. Temper your weapons. Prepare for the great and decisive battle. God on the right. God for the king. God for King Henry.
Thomas Portolin, born Isleworth, 1415. Late chief financial officer to my Earl of Warwick, known as Kingmaker. This chronicle set down as witness by one who was there. In 914 AD, the Lady of the Mercians, Ethelfleda, a late daughter of King Alfred the Great, began fortifying the small town of Warwick against attacks from inland marauding Danes. The castle proper was begun in 1068 by the Frenchman, William I, known as the Conqueror. Being French, he ordered the building to be made in his style. This was known as Mott and Bailey. It has to be said that to this diarist, this sounds rather like a somewhat poor court jester's double act. However, Mott means no more than mound, and Bailey, courtyard. Inside the courtyard were buildings. A timber hall with a thatched roof, a simple chapel, a kitchen, and a brew house. This protected and nurtured what had now become a community. There was a garrison of soldiers, servants, and stabling for horses. Trades were now established, a blacksmith's forge and an armorer's shop. Across the river was the simplest of wooden footbridges, spanning the natural crossover that already existed. No, I do not remember it. I do not recollect it. I am only a sparkling 70 years young. In 1260, further changes took place when stone became the major building material. It was locally cut. Further trades were added, and there was now a carpenter's, a stonemason's, and a wheelwright's. By Kingmaker's time, considerable changes had taken place. Two large stone towers had been added, and the wooden bridge that spanned the river had been refashioned in a fine stone structure with 14 arches. However, it must be said, to begin at the beginning, from the start, as it were, that Kingmaker only became Earl of Warwick by a stroke of fortune. By 1439, he was betrothed by his father to Anne Beecham. She was only 13, and he 11. She, it should be noted, only became Countess of Warwick by inheritance on the death of her 5-year-old niece in 1449. Now, and here is the crux of the matter. Why should this man, Warwick, Kingmaker, wish to have such an impact on the times? What drove him? There were many reasons, but I should like to draw your attention to two. The shadow of his father, the great Lord Salisbury, and his lack of a male heir. He only had daughters.
So, here he is, a glorious, shining 21, the Premier Baron of all England, Earl of Warwick, Newborough and Aumerle, Lord of Elmley and Hanslape, Glamorgan and Morgan, and more than 50 other estates besides. Sufficient power to be a king, but with no legitimate claim on the throne of England. Sometimes we spoke informally. I was, after all, a principal advisor. Once, thus, "We must trim your excesses of expenditure, my lord." "But Thomas," says he, "I wish to be another Caesar. I am dazzled by the shadow of greatness."
Did he mean his father? He clearly possessed a vision of the future, dreamed of a continental dominion over which he would rule. As governor of Calais, why should the man who would rescue the realm from disorder not dream of a princely crown? On another occasion, we spoke again.
"By all means, my lord, provide all your soldiers with red jackets with your badge of the ragged staff upon them. But we cannot afford such lavish expenditure. It would cost a king's ransom."
"Oh, Thomas, dear Thomas, friend Thomas," says he, "then we shall ransom a king." God's bones, I do believe I laughed. He did. I must describe his extravagant hospitality, for I believe this was another source of his motive for power. For instance, friends leaving in the small hours of the morning, if they left, I heard them through this very window before me. "What a man! What a supper! The jugglers and players, the musicians and dancers, such generosity! All are welcome at Warwick's house as if it were their own." And if they didn't leave? 6 ox roasted for breakfast, and only 30 persons present. On one occasion, he allowed, permitted, nay, instructed, that all members of the household should not return to their families unless they carried as much meat as they might hold upon the shaft of a long dagger. Aye, he was a man. Powerfully, foolishly kind and generous. To a fault. I cannot but conclude that it was these generosities, nay, indulgences, that drove him to take the part of Henry of Lancaster against Edward of York. Or Edward of York against Henry of Lancaster, depending on whether it was Tuesday or Thursday, whatever suited him on a given day. A man. A man. Thomas. Thomas! Work! Work, or it will never be done. The household. This was made up of two principal units, the inner and the foreign. The inner was the larger and more permanently organized and centered around the countess, her daughters, and their requirements and needs. Their retinue was 54. The foreign household was smaller and less complex and revolved around Kingmaker as he went about his duties at home or abroad. It numbered between 20 and 50. Troops being added in times of unrest or war. Military personnel in Kingmaker's service were made up from knights, who were in charge of the guards, squires, and messengers-at-arms who also performed sentry duty. The porter, a most ancient office, keeps the outer door of the castle. His importance cannot be stressed enough, controlling, as he does, all security from the outside world.
He received the not inconsiderable sum of a penny halfpenny a day,
and was also charged with attending the vineyard garden opposite the castle gate. Come his midday meal or supper time, he had the assistance of watchmen. At that time, how many years ago is it now? Nearly 15? God, bones! It seems like yesterday.
The battlements were patrolled by archers and crossbowmen. The ironworkers maintained the engines and guns of war. We were waiting. Ready. Ready and waiting for what was to come. I shall now embark on the sharp end of the action. The cut and thrust, as it were. The Wars of the Roses, the title given to the dynastic quarrel involving the families of York and Lancaster, began in 1455. The roses came from the visual emblems adopted by the two warring families. York chose the red rose, and Lancaster the white. The feud was only finally settled in 1485, with the coronation of the Lancastrian Henry Tudor as Henry VII, and his promise to marry Elizabeth of York. The royal household now have an emblem of the two roses entwined. It is known as the Tudor Rose. Richard Neville, 16th Earl of Warwick, remembered. By his marriage and the vast properties he owned, he was the power behind the English throne for nearly 20 years. At one time, he had the audacity to have two kings in captivity, Henry of Lancaster in the Tower of London and Edward of York here. It was for this reason that he was given the name Kingmaker, living frequently, as has been noted, like a king. I shall never forget, after the Battle of Edgecote in 1469 and the capture of Edward, how nothing could have demonstrated his character more clearly. All his energy and passion were poured into what he saw as the only role he wished to play. And the result. He had admirers, followers aplenty, but no real friends. Though never to be a king, he was convinced he was the natural representative of the cause of England. Being too responsible to plunge the country into chaos, he nevertheless cherished the notion that sooner or later the growing legend of Warwick would warm the hearts of England for his acceptance. He vigorously gathered the fruits of his success. He governed the country through the captive king, called to Parliament, but was denied acceptance by the nobility. He found himself compelled to release Edward. From this time, these two powerful men were set on a confrontational collision course. Diary at the time.
The roads to the castle are jammed with bright red jackets displaying Kingmaker's emblem of the ragged staff. We have afforded them. Headed by the officers of the estate, companies of yeomen arrive on horse or foot. They wear steel caps and padded leather tunics. They have bows on their shoulders and a sword in their belts, a quiver of clothyard shafts slung behind. Knights and squires ride in beneath their banners encased in steel corselets, or, if they are rich enough, full plate armor. Preparations have been proceeding for months.
Kingmaker has commanded that new armor be made for the battle to come. The blacksmith's forge can be heard by day and night, and seen glowing in the darkness. The sound of the armorer's hammering creates an eerie accompaniment to the imminent action. In the courtyard, the men are trained under Kingmaker's personal direction.
Each group, time and again, are made to run forward with a thick mat of knuckle cord of 3 fathoms length, 18 feet, and 4 feet broad. Positioned at every second knot stands a vicious, sharpened steel spike, waiting for the soft-fleshed tread of foot or hoof. Seamstresses sew tunics and tents for the field. Cobblers cobble, armorers arm. Blacksmiths go black in the blue shades of dawn and dusk, and blue with pumping their bellows in the black of night. All of Warwickshire is the castle, and the castle is Warwickshire. It is Easter time, 1401. Edward is in London. He devotes Good Friday to prayer, but by Saturday, he is back on the road, heading north, determined to intercept Kingmaker before he reaches London.
Meanwhile, Kingmaker has moved rapidly to Coventry, and then south to Barnet. His position is squarely across the main road to London. Warwick is commanding a reserve force, positioned behind the 3 main battalions, led by the Earl of Oxford, the Duke of Exeter, and directly in front of Kingmaker, his younger brother John Neville, Marquis of Montague. They are all fiercely equipped with cannons and guns. That night, under cover of darkness, Edward moves his 3 battalions to where he believes they are directly opposite the enemy. They are not. They are misaligned, far, far too far to their right. This will prove a devastatingly accidental advantage.
Dawn broke on Easter Sunday, the 14th of April, 1471, at about 4:30 a.m. During the night, a thick mist had arisen, all but obscuring the armies from each other. Battle is joined, and proves terrifying, even to the hardened. Cannon shot and arrows rain down in a cascade through the dense cloud that is enveloping everything. But soon, men are engaged in hand-to-hand combat, fighting to the death. Edward's younger brother, Richard of Gloucester, is now advancing downhill, so far to the right of the enemy that he is in danger of losing all contact with the battle. From the noise to his left, he quickly realizes this catastrophic error and swiftly commands his force to turn sharply and reclimb the slope. Here, he engages in fierce fighting. Gloucester himself is wounded, and many of his household are killed. What has happened is that due to the detrimental misalignment, the whole battle has turned through a complete quarter circle to the left. This appalling accident is to have tragic consequences due to the poor visibility. 2 of the emblems of the armies are almost identical. Kingmaker's allies attack each other. A great cry of treason goes up, and 1/4 of Kingmaker's forces flee the field. Thus began the disintegration of Warwick's forces. During this exchange, Kingmaker's younger brother is killed. Seeing his death, the heart goes out of him, and he runs for safety.
But it was that day, Easter Sunday, my master died. He was fighting in the field without horse. They caught him, lifted his helmet, stabbed him. My Earl Warwick! Kingmaker.
His death ended all resistance. The battle had lasted only 3 or 4 hours, by which time 3,000 men lay dead or dying. King Edward IV gave thanks to God.
In London the following day, as proof to any who might doubt Kingmaker's death, Edward ordered that his body be placed for exhibition before Our Lady of Grace in St. Paul's Cathedral. After 2 days, the body is taken for burial at Bisham Abbey, the ancestral tomb of the Nevilles. What can I add? The stairway that he climbed was as deserved as many. But for him, its substance was mostly illusion. He was as able as any man, but created to err. He had the capacity to make an enormous impact upon men's minds, but was deeply sensitive to the power of that impact. He struggled to play a high role upon the world stage, but was faced with the prompting of a dream. He was the mightiest of English earls. He was my earl, Warwick, King.